Communication interface, it is for serial data transfer. Already you have studied in internet networks. And next one is DA, digital and analog converter, and A by D converter, and then timer. And next one is the interrupt controller. The chip number is 8259. It is used to control the interrupts because 86 have only one interrupt request line and one interrupt acknowledge line. So if you want more number of interrupts lines, we have to cascade an interrupt controller to the main processor, 86 processor, and then DMA controller. And next one is we'll be studying about keyboard and display controller, how we are controlling the keyboard and the display. The chip number is 8279, and some case studies. It is the traffic light controller, LED display, LCD display, and then alarm controller. So today we are going to see about how we are interfacing memory and I/O. Okay. So already you have seen this diagram. So here we have the CPU, and to this CPU we have connected this 8255. It is used for parallel data transfer, and 8251 is used for serial data transfer. And we have the DMA controller in the right side, and here we have 8272, which is used to control the keyboard and display. In addition to this, we will be having the interrupt controller, the A by D converter, like that. Okay. So why we are going for an interface? Actually, here an interface provides a method for transferring information between the internal storage and the external storage. Okay. So internal storage is nothing but the CPU, and external storage is nothing the peripheral devices. Okay. So to interface both this, we need some special communication lines. So special communication lines are nothing but this interface. So why we are going for this interface? Actually, here the CPU is an electronic device, okay, and here the peripherals are electromagnetic devices. So here both the signals are different, and we have to synchronize both the signals, okay, data flow. So we are using an interface. So for example, if we have an English speaking person and also a Hindi speaking, so both of them, if they are not able to understand the language, means we will be having a translator in between them, okay. Like this, here to synchronize the data flow between the processor and the peripheral devices, we go for this interface. Another one thing is, here when we take the data transfer rate, the processor data transfer rate will be very fast, and for the peripheral devices, it will be very slow. Okay. And also here, the third one is data will be in the form of codes in the CPU and codes in the peripheral, and it will be in the form of words in the processor. So to avoid these three, that is to synchronize all this data flow, we have an interface. Okay. So here, why an interface is needed? So the conversion, as I said earlier, CPU is an electronic device and peripherals are electromagnetic device. Okay. So a conversion of signal needs needed here. So we are going for an interface. And when compared with the data transfer rate, the peripherals, it is very slow, and the CPU, it is very fast. And the data codes and formats are used in the peripherals. And in the case of CPU, we are using the word format. Okay. So synchronize all these 3 points, we are going for an interface. So here, an interface is a concept that refers to a point of interaction between components and is applicable at the level of both hardware and software. So this interface allows a function, that is a component, to function independently while using interfaces to communicate with other components via an input-output system and an associated protocol. Okay. So here, let's see an interface. So this is an interface here. So see, here we can see the switches, no? Here, this connectors link through this USB, and here we have HDMI, and this is an interface board. This will be converting the signals, okay? So every vessel, let's see here, a keyboard interface. So here we have to connect the keyboard. Here we have an interface. Interface board is nothing but an add-on card. So when you open the CPU to the main motherboard, we'll be having some interface cards like this. Suppose if you want to extend the RAM capacity, means so you'll be adding some extended RAMs. Am I right? Okay. So here, that is the interface card, add-on card. Suppose if you're having an old CPU and we are going to use for playing games, means so graphics card will not be there. So if we add a graphics card to that CPU, So we can use it for games also. Okay. So yeah, I think you understood what is an interface. So every device, what is a mouse means, it'll be having an interface. It is add-on card. So without that interface card, the devices cannot be connected to the CPU. Okay. So let's see about memory and I/O interfacing. So here we have the microprocessor and we have ROM, DRAM, and then the keyboard and the printer. So here the control bus, the system bus, which consists of address bus, data bus, and control signals. So address bus is unidirectional. Why address bus is unidirectional? So put your answers in the chat box, or anyone can unmute yourself and tell me. Kalyan Kumar, are you able to see the next image that is not available?
No, ma'am, I think it will take some time, I guess.
Why it's not coming? The
Yes, ma'am. Now it got changed.
What are you getting? Some sentence or image?
Memory interface. No. Memory interface. Now it's diagram, ma'am. Like memory bus architecture, okay. Those diagrams.
But in my mobile, it's not there. Okay, fine. You're getting, no? Okay. So here we have
this
address bus. Address bus is unidirectional. Why address bus is unidirectional? Students, are you there? So data bus is bidirectional. Address bus is unidirectional. Data bus is bidirectional. Students, are you able to see the image and some architecture image? Yeah. Why address bus is unidirectional? No, I only requested. Yeah, Vignesh. So address bus is used to locate the memory. Okay, so it is unidirectional. Data bus is used to read the data and also write the data. Okay, it will perform two operations, reading and writing. So it is bidirectional. And control bus is no signal. Okay, so here we have, these are the control signals, memory write cycle, memory read, I/O write, and I/O read. Okay, so here we have the ROM. So from ROM, read only memory, we can read only the data. So we have only unidirectional, okay? And DRAM is dynamic random access memory. So here we can read and also write the data. So here it is represented as bidirectional, okay? And here keyboard is an input device. From the keyboard, you can read the data. So it is the direction like this. And printer is an output device. So we can write the data into the printer and we have this direction like this. Okay, so address bus is unidirectional. Why means it represents only the memory location. Okay, so address bus is unidirectional. Data bus is bidirectional means, so we have to read and write the data into the memory or the I/O devices. So data bus is bidirectional. Okay, so here we can read only the data from ROM. So we have this control signal memory read. Okay. And from DRAM, we can read and also write the signal. So we have the control signals two control signals to DRAM. Okay, memory write and memory read. And when coming to this keyboard, it is an input device. So we have to read the data from keyboard. So we have I/O read. Okay, and printer is an output device. So we can write the data. So the control signal for this printer is I/O write. So hope you understood this memory and I/O interfacing. Okay, so how we are doing this memory interfacing is, so when we are executing an instruction, suppose if you want to fetch a data from memory, first one is the address. We have must know the address. Okay, so the address will be sent out by the microprocessor. And second one is we have to select the chip. So for example, in 86, we have two banks, no, odd bank or even bank. So we have to select from which bank we are going to get the data. So we have to select the chip by using a decoding circuit. And next one is the control signal, whether we are going to read or write the data. Okay, the next one is the interfacing process includes matching the memory requirements with the microprocessor, then the matching the signals. And the interface circuit design in such a way that it matches the memory signal requirements with the microprocessor and also the peripheral devices. This is memory interfacing. And here there are types of interfaces. There is a memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. So we have two address space here, memory address space and I/O address space. Okay. So if I/O is mapped with memory, it is called as memory mapped I/O. Okay, I/O is mapped with memory means it is memory mapped I/O. And if the I/O is mapped with the I/O address space, it is called as I/O mapped I/O. So there are two types of interface, memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. Okay. If I/O is mapped with memory, it is called as memory mapped I/O. And I/O is mapped with the I/O address space, it is called as I/O mapped I/O. So let's see the difference between this memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. So here the I/O devices are treated as memory, and here I/O is treated as I/O only. Okay. So here the memory mapped I/O, the address is 16-bit address is used to refer the memory, and here in I/O mapped I/O it is 8-bit address. So in the later stages we'll be knowing that why we are going for this memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. And here we can have 2^16 locations. Okay, here we have 16-bit address, so 2^16 locations can be used here. And here, can you tell me the answer for I/O mapped I/O? How many address space locations will be available? In memory mapped I/O, 2^16 locations. Yeah, it is 2^8 locations. Yeah, Swati. And here the memory instructions are used. Okay, whatever you have within square bracket, no? Square bracket means refers the memory. So like that, the instructions will be used here. Here we use this in and out instruction. So in instruction is used to read the data from the peripherals, and out instruction is used to send the data out to the peripheral devices. Okay. Here the memory mapped I/O is the data transfer between register and I/O. And in I/O mapped I/O, it is a data transfer between accumulator and I/O. It's very important. In I/O mapped I/O, that is in and out instruction. So suppose if you are using in instruction, means from the device, the data will be transferred to the accumulator only, not any other registers. Okay. So in I/O mapped I/O, the data transfer will be between accumulator and I/O. So these are the differences between this memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. This may be asked for 2 marks or 8 marks like that. Okay, differences between the two methods, memory mapped I/O and I/O mapped I/O. And now we are going to study about this 8255. This is programmable peripheral interface. Okay, so by using this 8255, we can transfer the data in parallel. So already we know that for serial data transmission, we are using 8251 USART. Okay, you have studied in computer networks. For parallel data transfer, we are using this 8255. So see here, 8086, and we have this 8255. By using this 8255, all the 8 bits can be transferred out to the output devices. Here we have the sender and the receiver. So to send the data out to the receiver, we can have this 8255. Okay, let's see here. I/O ports. Here we have this input device and the output device. So we are going to use this in and out instruction. So already I have told this example. So here we have a motherboard which is connected with 8 LEDs. Okay, 8 LEDs. So I want to make this on. That is, I want to make all the LEDs to be in the on state, means I have to give 1 to all these LEDs. Okay, so I have to find the data. So all the bits are 1, 1 means the data will be FF. Okay, this is a program, simple program here. So FF means all the 8 bits will be 1, 1, 1. So that is moved to accumulator and output. So after execution of these 2 lines, so we can see all the LEDs will be in the on stage. Okay, so this is the example for 8255. This is parallel data transfer. Through this ports, the data can be transferred to the output devices. So here I have taken 8 LEDs as an output device connected with the motherboard. So I want to connect, make it on. Okay, so I am moving the data 111 to the accumulator, and I am outputting that output. So all the LEDs will be in the on stage. Okay, so let's see in detail about 8255. So 8255 has three ports. Okay, port A, port B, and port C, each of 8 bits. Port A is 8 bits. Port B is 8 bits. Port C is another 8 bits. So 8 into 3, totally we have 24 bits. Okay, so at the same time, we can transmit 24. Am I right? 24. Yeah. 24 bits to the output devices. Okay, so depending upon the application, suppose I need only 8 bits can be sent out, means so I can go for either port A, port B, or port C. Suppose I need 16 bits for that application, means we can go for port A or port B, or port B and port C. Like this, depending upon the applications, we can go for the selection of the ports, port A, port B, and port C. Okay, so each of 8 bits. So this is another diagram here. Actually, here port A, we have it is represented by PA7 to PA0. Okay, 8 bits are there. So port C is divided into 2 sections. That is port C upper and port C lower. Okay, so port C upper consists of PC7 to 4, and the lower consists of PC3 to 0. And port B is here, we have PB7 to 0. So why we are dividing this port C is, so port C is used for handshake signals. So what do you mean by handshake signals? Can you give an example for handshake signal? Handshake signals. Because when you're transmitting the data from one source to destination, so we must know whether the data have been reached at the destination. So for that, we are using some signal. Am I right? So what are the signals we are using? So what is the use of acknowledge signal? What is the use of acknowledge signal? To acknowledge signal, students, I cannot see any answers in the chat box. What is the use of acknowledge signal? No, that the message, yeah, very good, Vignesh, okay. So acknowledge signal is after, so when we receive the acknowledge signal, we can understand that the data is received at the destination. Okay. So acknowledge signal will be sent by the from the destination. Someone is disturbing. Who is that? I can hear some voices. Can you unmute yourself? So acknowledge signal is a signal sent from the destination. Knowing that, it has received the data. So for the handshake signals, we are using this port C bus. So it is divided into 2 parts. Okay, port C upper and port C lower. So this port C upper will be used by port A, and port C lower will be used by port B to represent the handshake signals while data transfer. And we have this VCC, then ground pin, and we have the data. So, okay, D7 to 0, 8-bit input. And we have the read signal, write signal, and CS is nothing but the chip select signal. CS is chip select signal. and we have the reset signal, and A1 and A0 is used to select the ports. If it is 0, 0 means port A will be selected, and 0, 1 means port B, like this. For selection of the ports, we are using this A0 and A1. Bhavana? So here, 8255 consists of 3 ports, okay, port A, port B and port C. Port A is 8 bits, port B is 8 bits and port C is also 8 bits. So port C is used for handshake signals, okay. So here it is divided into 2 parts, port C upper and port C lower. So this is each of 4 bits. So port C upper will be used by port A, and port C lower will be used by port B while data transfer to represent the handshake signals. So these are some of our applications of 8255. See here, I am displaying the hours, minutes and seconds here. So to display the hours, I am using port C. Okay, here 4 bits are connected to this LED, and another 4 bits is connected to this LED. Okay, then for this minutes, I am going to use this port B, and here 4 bits is used here, and another 4 bits for another LED. And here to display the seconds, I am having 2 displays. So it is connected to port A. Suppose I want to display years, months and dates also. So I have to go for another 8255. Okay, so here we have used all the 8 bits. So here port C is used, port A is used and port B also used. Again, I want to display the years, months and dates. So I'm going for another 8255. Okay, so like this, depending upon the application, we can go for, there is 8255 can be cascaded to the main processor. So we'll be studying this only in the case studies. Okay, how we are designing this and what is the programming we are going to do like this. So here, see here 8 LEDs are connected in the same line. So in this, we can display your names or some rolling displays. So we'll be, as an advertisement, we'll be receiving, seeing the displays, you know, in the top of the building, we'll be having some displays. Welcome. Or whatever it is, the advertisement of a shop or like that, you will be seeing this. So this is an LED display example, okay? So here, port A is used and port B also used here, and port C is not used, okay? So to design this 8-digit LED display, we are using port A and port B. Okay, so here we have 8 segments connected together. So by using this, we can display the words like welcome or rolling display. That is, the words will be rolling. So you'll be seeing the advertisements in the top of the building. We can see the displays like this. So nowadays we are not going for LED display. We are using LCD display. Am I right? So in the hotels you can see this LCD display, no? So this rate will be displayed like using this LCD display. See here, port A is used for data transfer here. And port B, 3 bits are used, okay, PB0, PB1 and PB2 are used, okay. So this is an LCD display. And here the keyboard is also interfaced to this 8255 only, okay. So here port A and port B is used for keyboard interface. So in the later stage, we'll be seeing how we are interfacing the keyboards and display everything, okay. This is an example for 8255. Like this, here it is used to interface a stepper motor interface. It is stepper motor. So this stepper motors are used in robo, no, to move forward or take an equipments like this. So for that also, we are using this 8255. So 8255 is a programmable peripheral interface, which is used to transfer the data in parallel. Don't forget, in parallel. Okay. So here, let's see about this 8255. We have, basically, there are 2 modes, okay, BSR and IO mode. BSR means bit set reset mode. Bit set reset mode, which is used to control the port C bits only, because port C bits are used for handshake signals, okay. So this BSR mode is used to control only the port C bits. Bit set reset mode. Why we are going for this BSR mode means, since port C contains only the handshake signals, we are using this BSR mode. So next one is, we have this IO mode. It is further divided into mode 0, mode 1 and mode 2. So now let's see here. So this is the control, as I said earlier, every device, every chip will be having a control word register and a status register, okay? So control register is used to control that device, and status register is used to read the status if there is any problem. Okay, for debugging, we can read the register. So at that time, it is called a status register. Okay, control register is used to control the device, and status register is used to read the status. So this is the structure of the control register. Here, the D7th bit represents whether the first two modes we have now, whether it is BSR mode or IO mode. So BSR mode means bit set reset. It is used only for port C bits because we are using port C bits for handshake signals. Okay, so this is BSR mode. Then here IO mode, it is divided into three modes, mode 0, mode 1 and mode 2. So mode 0, it is for simple data transfer. All the ports, port A, B and C will be used for simple data transfer. Just we can send the data out and also we can receive the data. Okay, just simple data transfer. And here in mode 1, port A and B are used for data transfer and port C is used for handshake. Hope you got it, okay? So mode 1 is port A and B is used for data transfer and port C is used for handshake signals. So in mode 2, port A is used for bidirectional and port B is used for data transfer. It can be either in mode 0 or mode 1, and port C is used for handshake signals. Okay, there are three modes. Mode 0, all the ports are used for simple data transfer. Just we can transfer the data without checking any conditions, okay? But in IO mode, there is mode 1, port A and B is used for data transfer and port C is used for handshake signals. And in mode 2, port A is used for bidirectional data transfer and port B can be either in mode 0 or 1 and it is used for data transfer and port C is used for handshake signals. So they may ask this about this IO mode in 2 months question, what it is, okay? So normally in all these modes, port C is used for handshake signals only. So depending upon the applications, what we are going for, we have to select the IO modes. So it can be mode 0, mode 1 or mode 2. Okay. So now here, see here, suppose if you are placing the data bus, data's here. After placing the data in the data bus, we are giving a strobe signal. Strobe signal is nothing but a handshake signal indicating that I have placed the data. The processor giving an information to the output device that I have placed a data in the data bus. So the output device, after receiving the data, it will give an acknowledge signal stating that I have received the data. Okay, so this is some of the examples for handshake signal, strobe signal, acknowledge signal like this. Okay. So let's see about this BSR mode. So BSR mode is set bit. Set reset mode, which is used for port C. Okay, 8 bits of port C can be used for handshake signal. So we have this bit set reset mode. So here, this is the structure of the control register. Okay, so here, let's see, the D7th bit must be 0. So when it is 0, it represents it is an BSR mode. If it is 1 means it refers to IO mode. So as I see in the previous image. Okay. So now let's see this D0. So now whether we are going to set or reset. If it is 1 means we are going to set, otherwise it is reset, okay? So which bit we are going to use here as a, as a signal. Whether we have the strobe and acknowledge signal, no? Which signal we are going to use as a handshake signal? That must be set here, okay? Let's see an example here. So let's take this. So after placing the data bus, okay, I am giving the strobe signal. So I have to find the value here, okay, in this register. So I am representing here D0, D1, D2, D3, D4. Let us take an example here. I have connected this strobe signal to the 7th bit, okay. So port C contains of how many bits? 8 bits. So to the 7th bit, I have connected this strobe signal. The strobe signal is active low signal. So in order to activate, this must be 0. So here, see here, so D0 represents bit set reset. since strobe signal is active low, I have to reset. Okay, I have put 0. Since the strobe signal is connected to the 7th bit, see here, 7th bit value is 1, 1, 1. Okay, I'm putting the value here, 1, 1, 1. Then D4, D5, D6, X means it is don't care. So I'm taking it as 0. And here D7 must be 0. Okay, so this is the data I have to. So the equivalent value is 0E. And I write here out CWR. After execution of this instruction, so here it will be sending the strobe signal to the output device. Okay, I hope you got it. So after placing the data bus, I have to send a strobe signal to the output device, indicating that output device that I have placed a data, so you can receive the data. Okay, so now for example, I have taken the strobe signal is connected to the 7th bit. And since it is active low signal, I'm substituting here value D0 as 0 and 7 bit. Okay, 7 is equivalent to 111. So I'm putting the value 111 in D3, D2, D1. And here D4, D5, D6 are don't care condition. And I have taken as 0 and D7 must be 0. It is a condition here. D7 must be 0. So the equivalent value for this is 0E, and I have written here out CWR. So after the execution of this, the strobe signal will be given to the output device. Okay. So like this only you have to write the programs. So now let's see the pin diagram of 8255. So already we have seen this diagram. Okay. So it is a 40 pin. See here, PA0, PA1. 2, 3, the right side we are having 4, 5, 6, 7, okay, 40. So, port A is 8 bits. So, we have 1 to 4 and 40 to 37 are used to represent port A bits. So, next one is 5th pin is used to represent the read signal. 6th one is chip select signal, okay, CS is chip select, to select the chip. Next one is we have ground. And A0 and A1 is used to select the ports, whether we are using port A or port B or port C. And then from pin number 10 to 17, we are representing the port C bits, okay? 10 to 17 port C bits. Then 18, 19, 20, and 21, 22, 23, 24, and 25 are used to represent port B bits. And then we have VCC. And D7 to D1 is used to represent the data bus, okay? And then we have the reset signal and the write signal. This is a pin diagram of 8255. It is a 40 pins. So for 2 marks also, they may ask to draw the pin diagram of 8255. Okay? So 8255 is a programmable peripheral interface which is used to transfer the data in parallel. Okay? So this is the block diagram of 8255. See here, as I said earlier, so group A, it is divided into 2 parts, okay, group A and group B control. So group A is connected as port A and port C upper. Okay, when port A is used for data transfer in mode 2 or mode 1, so handshake signals will be available in port C upper. Like this group B, we have port B and also connected to port C lower. So this is used to represent the handshake signals, okay? So here we have the data bus buffer. This will be connected to the microprocessor for data transfer to synchronize the processor and 8255, okay? And here we have the control logic. So read signal, write signal, and A0 and A1 is used to select the ports. So see here, the table 00 means it will be used to select port A, and 01 means port B, 10 means port C, and 11 means control register. Okay, and then we have the read set signal and chip select signal. Okay? So this is a block diagram of 8255. So what is 8255? Is a programmable peripheral interface which is used to transfer the data in parallel. Okay. So this is the main part. This is a control word register. Suppose if you want to set the ports as input or output, so we have to find out some values in this. And then if you write here out CWR means according to that, all the ports will be such. Okay, so we'll be seeing some example. Now let's see what it represents. As I said here, D7th bit. See here, this is very important. It must be one for I/O mode. As I said earlier, there are two modes, BSR mode and I/O mode. If it is zero, means it is BSR mode. That is bit set reset mode, which is used to control port C bits. Okay, and one means it is I/O mode. That is for data transfer. We have as again divided into three modes. Okay, mode zero, mode one, and mode two. Now let's see here. D0, which is used to represent port C lower bits. Okay, lower bits. So if it is set as one, means port C lower will be used as input. If it is put, if you write here zero, means it will be set as output. Suppose if you have set as one, means it will be used only for input. Okay, so suppose if you want to set as output, means we have to reset it again. You have to redefine it. Okay, so if you put one, so port C will be used as input, and here this D1 is used to control port B. If it is one, means it is used as input, and if it is zero, means it is output. And here it is used for port B, whether it is mode zero or mode one. And next one we have this group A. Okay. So port C upper combined with port A is group A. So port C, if it is one, means it is used as input, and zero means it is output. Then this D4th bit is used to control the port A bits, okay? Whether it can be input or output. And here the mode selection, whether it is mode 0, 1 or 2. Now let's see some examples here. Okay, so now we are going to find out the control word register value. So in mode 0, we are going to transfer the data. So in this port A, we are going to define port A as output, port B as input, and port C lower as input, and port C upper as input. So find the control word register value. So this will be the question for 2 marks. Okay. So we have to find the control word register value. So let's see here. I have drawn this. First is, we are going for check. We have to check whether it is BSR mode or I/O mode. So just we are going to data transfer. So that is I/O mode. So I'm putting the value 1 here. Okay. Okay, next one is port A must be used as output. So see here, D4th bit is used as to control port A. Okay, D4th bit is used to control port A. So I'm as output. So 0 here. The next one is port B as input. So here port B, so D2 bit is used to represent, sorry, port B here. D1 bit is used to represent port B. So this is, I am going to use as input. So I am putting the value 1 here. Okay. So next one is port C lower as input. So we have to find out here port C lower, this one, port C lower, D0th bit. I'm going to use as input, so 1, okay? So next one is port C upper as output. So here D3 refers port C upper. I'm going to use as output, so I have put the value 0, okay? So next one is I have to refer the modes. What is the mode here? All the, there's port A, port B, port C in mode 0 only. So see here, port A in mode 0, so I'm substituting the value 00 here, and port B in mode 0, so I have put the value 0 here. Okay. So according to this, the value in the control word register is 83, so I have moved that to accumulator and out to CWR. Here the condition is the value must be moved to the accumulator only, okay, out CWR. So after execution of this, so here, according to this problem, port A will be designed as output only, and port B as input, and port C lower as input, and port C upper as output. Okay. So according to this definition only, we can use this port. Suppose if I want to change this port A as input mode, I have to redefine the value. Okay. So let's see another example here. So you'll be asked to write a program. Routine required to program the 8255 for mode 0 with port A as an output and port B and C as inputs. Okay, I have drawn the register D0 to D7. So first let's see here, port A must be defined as output, port A. Okay, first one is this must be 1. Okay, and here port A as an output. So port A here, D4th bit is used to refer port A. So I'm here, port A must be defined as an output, so 0. Okay, and next one is port B must be defined as input, port B and C. So port B is D1, so 1. Then port C as input. So lower 1, upper also 1. Okay. Next one is you have to refer the modes. What is the mode here? It is mode 0. So here also we have 0, 0. Here also we have 0. So the value according to this is 8B out CWR. Hope you got it. So you must know the control word register content by heart. So study that. Then the problem will be like this. Okay, with port A, so you have to define port A as an input and port B and C as inputs. So according to that, you have to find the values in the control word register and put that value in the accumulator. It must be in accumulator only. And then you write out CWR. According to this, this A to 5A will be set. Okay, this is mode 1 that we complete. There's only two more diagrams, please be online. See here, in mode 0 is, what is it? It is simple data transfer. And mode 1 is port A and B is used for data transfer and port C is used for handshake signals. So let's see what are the handshake signals. So see this diagram here. Port A is used as input and port B is also input, right? Both are used as input. So let's see the handshake signal. So here, the strobe signal here, you know that, no? Strobe signal is input the data into the port and we have this IBF, that is input buffer full. So indicating that the input latch contains the information, okay? So these are the two handshake signals used when port A is used as input, okay? Strobe signal and input buffer full signal. You know this, no? Interrupt request signal, INTR. And this is INTA is interrupt enable signal. So see here, we have a suffix A here. Since it is used by port A, we are having a suffix A. And the bottom diagram, we have suffix B because this handshake signals are used by port B. Okay. See the handshake signals are connected to this port C bit, C3, C2, C1. And here again, C3, C5, upper bits. This is upper bits and here we have the lower bits. Okay, this is mode 1. Again, mode 1 here we are using port A as output and port B as output. So here the handshake signals we are using is output buffer full and acknowledge signal. So in the previous one we used input buffer full and strobe signal, and here when it is when the ports are used as output port, the handshake signals are output buffer and acknowledge signal. Okay. Next one is the mode 2 is here. Port A is used for bidirectional. See here, port A and B are used for bidirectional. And here, all the signals are combined together. Here in mode 2, see strobe signal, IBF signal, input buffer signal. Then we have this OBF, output buffer signal and acknowledge signal. Okay. So strobe and input buffer signal will be used when the ports are used as input. And when the ports are used as output, it will be having this output buffer full and acknowledge signal. That's all. So here, this is the 8255 interface board that will be available in your lab. By using this, we'll be doing some experiments. Okay, this is the, I hope you have seen, this is the interface, this is the microprocessor kit. Okay, so here now there is a bus connector. Can you see this? Here, this bus connector, by using a bus cable, so this will be connected to this end. This end and this end will be connected together and be using some application. That is, we'll be seeing some programs. So here, this is port A. 8 LEDs we are having as port A, and this is the port C dip switches. Okay, and port C is used for handshake signals, no? So here, this is the handshake signals. So suppose if you are placing the, after placing the data, just you press some kind of pins connected to this means so the few purpose this key, so it indicates that data is available. Okay, so this is port A LED and this is port B, so we'll be seeing that in the next class. Okay, it's time. Okay, oh thank you, hope you understood this 8255. What is 8255?